Secondary plenary speaker, Bran Nicol, to give traditional, it is now becoming a tradition, Professor Talat Halman Memorial Lecture. Professor Talat Halman passed away on the 5th of December 2014. He was an eminent poet, a scholar, a translator with international renown. Also back in the 1970s, he was the first Minister of Culture and Arts on the Turkish cabinet. With reference to the idea, he was our honorary member. And he always supported and encouraged us at the IDEA. Moreover, he honored several of our conferences with inspiring talks and dramatic presentations from Shakespeare. In an obituary published on the 16th of December 2014 in the New York Times, he was remembered as follows. Quote, "The world's literary and cultural stage has lost a truly unique and irreplaceable talent, poet, translator, columnist, belletrist, accomplished academic, diplomat, charismatic public speaker, social and cultural critic, writers, activist, and much more. All of these contributions, plus his willingness to share his wisdom and knowledge, will be remembered by the countless audiences he enlightened, the numerous students he inspired and encouraged, and the future generations who will benefit from this legacy." This is the obituary published in the New York Times upon his death. Last year, the IDEA General Council unanimously adopted a resolution that at each international IDEA conference to be held, one of the plenaries be delivered as the Professor Talat Halman Memorial Lecture. So for this conference, Bran Nicol has kindly accepted to deliver this lecture. So we are honored to have Bran as the Talat Halman Memorial Lecturer today. Bran Nicol, to many of you, is well known through his expertise in postmodernism, in hermeneutics, and of course, through his widely read scholarly publications. Currently, he teaches at the University of Surrey, United Kingdom, and there he is a professor of English literature, and also he is the head of the School of English and Languages. He's a University of Lancaster man because he got his PhD from this university, writing his thesis on the work of the novelist and the also philosopher Iris Murdoch. He has taught at the universities of Chichester and Portsmouth, where he was the director of the Center for Studies in Literature. His books include The Private Eye, published by Reaction in 2013. This is, of course, well known to you, Postmodern Fiction, An Introduction, published by Cambridge University Press in 2009, and Stalking, published by Reaction 2006, which was also translated into several languages, including Italian, Japanese, and Korean. Iris Murdoch, The Retrospective Fiction, another book published by Palgrave as the second in 2004, and also two edited collections, Postmodernism and the Contemporary Novel, published by Edinburgh University Press, 2002, and The Crime Culture, published by Bloomsbury, 2010. So, Professor Nicol is mostly interested, and especially in British, European and American fiction, and crime fiction. Only 2 weeks ago at Matthew, they had the Agatha Christie conference, and it would have been a wonderful occasion for you and for us to hear your ideas of crime fiction, and also film. So he has presented his research in these areas at universities around the world. And now he is at Chanka University. So the name of Chanka University will be added to his rostrum of universities that you've been through, yes. So he's, you know, hardworking, very productive, currently completing The Value of Postmodernism for Cambridge University. The Value of Postmodernism, because postmodernism has come under very severe criticism from all sides, and the especially after the 9/11, there was this reaction against post-structuralism and postmodernism that is killing meaning and the people no longer having any value, any pleasure of these moral values and so forth. So The Value of Postmodernism, I'm sure, will be a very controversial book, as well as editing the forthcoming collection. This is, will be surely a sort of desktop reference book, The Cambridge Companion to British Postmodern Fiction. So today, So, towards a postmodern hermeneutics, from suspicion to sincerity in contemporary Western literature. So, Professor Nicol.
Value of Postmodernism. It wasn't my title, it was a title suggested to me by the publisher, Cambridge. And at first I wasn't sure, because a question that a lot of English academics will automatically ask is, what is the value of postmodernism? You know? And why still write about postmodernism? And so I kind of want to talk about that in what follows. But first, I want to express my gratitude. I want to thank all the organisers of the conference, especially Uslan and Mustafa, and all their team. I know how much hard work goes into a conference, and this has run so smoothly. It's been such a hospitable and dynamic conference so far. I might change all that. I'm delighted to be here, so thank you very much for the invitation. But I'm also deeply honoured to be giving the Talat Halman Memorial keynote address. I mean, I've been reading about Talat Halman and some of his works, and I can say that he is truly an admirable figure for academics and the humanities. For one obvious reason, he just published so much, it makes you feel inadequate. You know, he published over 3,000 articles, newspaper columns, reviews in English and in Turkish, translated over 10,000 poems, and wrote over 80 books. But I think what especially impresses me is suggested by a line in the New York Times obituary, which Emmett quoted. It was Halman's humanism and cross-cultural approach that's his most lasting legacy. And I think his work as a translator from English into Turkish and Turkish into English produced what is an absolutely valuable cross-cultural exchange. Perhaps now more than ever, cross-cultural exchange is crucial, and it's our duty, I think, in the humanities to preserve that tradition. So Halman was, for example, William Faulkner's translator. So he kind of carried across. Translation, of course, means carrying across. That's the original notion of the term, and I think that's very important. Halman also said, in a quotation I admire, that culture as a unifying force, that when culture develops, humanism begins. And I think in these times, globally, you could almost turn it the other way around and think that when culture collapses, humanism ends. So I think it's our duty to preserve humanism. So I'm delighted to be here from the UK in Turkey, kind of embodying cross-cultural exchange and to be working with Turkish academics who do such a valuable job, I think, in the country. I think as academics do in every country. I know that there are other nationalities here too. So what I want to talk about is a kind of carrying across, in a sense. It's probably a bit too ambitious to call Western literature. I'm not aiming to speak for Western literature, but I'm certainly talking about the Anglo-American tradition, and in particular the American tradition. And it is this question of value that interests me. So I wasn't sure about the title at first, but I do think there's a general move towards re-establishing ethics as a key term in contemporary study. And values in particular are a key thing. So I think it's widely assumed that postmodernism is over now, and I would say that too. Whether or not it means postmodernism has mutated into something different, into a new form, or whether it's completely ended, I'm not sure. Personally, I think postmodernism has continued in a sense, but we are still post-postmodern. It's not the most satisfactory label. There have been many others, such as technomodernism, ultramodernism, digimodernism, hypermodernism. But I think post-postmodernism is quite a useful one because it's not specific enough yet. We know we're kind of after the moment of high postmodernism. Just let me work out how to use this. You probably notice that's a shameless copy of Eileen's transition technique in the slide yesterday. It's actually not quite the same. It's almost a copy. Seeing as you're talking about copies, I thought it was your work. But so in a novel, Raymond Federman's Aunt Rachel's Fur. Raymond Federman was one of the high postmodernists, one of the key writers of metafiction in the US, about the 60s and 70s. In his novel, Aunt Rachel's Fur, there's a novelist who is unable to get his novel published because the publisher says it's too postmodern. And he then justifies this by saying it's sad to see postmodernism disappear before we have a chance to explain it. And then he goes through, ironically, he goes through a list of names. Post-postmodernism seems too clumsy, and Popo Momo, not serious enough. Now, I've since become aware that Popo Momo has a different connotation in Turkish. Perhaps it's an appropriate connotation. Maybe Federman was aware of this. I don't know, but what's interesting, I think, is how a novelist like this is very conscious of postmodernism as a movement. Postmodernism, perhaps more than any other movement, is one which writers are aware of as they write. So Federman's not alone, there are many other novelists who actually build in a discussion of postmodernism into their text and actually explore the questions of beginning and ending. Now that would be a different paper. What I'm interested here is this question of naming the beast looming in front of us, which is one of the things that Federman's character, who is a kind of thinly disguised version of himself, says, that it's important to do this, he thinks. It's known as the big tent approach. Postmodernism is seen as the big tent approach, that you kind of cover everything in cultural theory by one particular label. It works with something like post-structuralism or post-colonialism too. But with postmodernism, it's almost like the tent has its own ecosystem, and everything that's produced in culture at that time is therefore postmodern. It's a problematic notion, but there's a value in it. And it goes, if we go back to Frederick Jameson's classic book, Postmodernism or the Cultural Logic of Late Capitalism, he says that if we do not achieve some general sense of a cultural dominant, then we fall back into a view of present history as sheer heterogeneity, random difference. And the aim of his book, as he said back then, was to project some conception of a new systematic cultural norm. And I do think that is important to have some kind of category, but I think more flexible than a big tent. Maybe just a sleeping bag or something, out rough, I don't know. But in today's talk, I don't really want to talk about these grand labels. I want to approach the question from a different angle, a more specific, in many ways more local one. And there's a number of other critics are doing. What I want to do is compare specific aspects of classic or high postmodernism in literature with contemporary literature produced very recently in the 21st century. What I want to focus on in particular is suggested more by the form rather than the content of the Federn extract. Self-reflexivity, metafiction, and in particular frame-breaking, those classic definitive postmodern techniques. So the topic's about coming after postmodernism in Federn, but it presents this awareness in the form which is the most associated with postmodernism, that's metafiction. Now, metafiction itself is undergoing a kind of rethinking, which is badly needed. In his book 21st Century Fiction, A Critical Introduction, Peter Boxall, a British critic, identifies what he considers a different kind of self-conscious narrative favoured by 21st century writers, different from the kinds of metafiction, he says, that dominated the later decades of the last century, which leads to the wearily postmodern conclusion that all life is a fiction, that we are all fictional characters in search of an author. So note the term wearily. He represents a common viewpoint among scholars of contemporary fiction. How can we get beyond this particular label? And he argues, I don't think it's completely convincing actually, but he does argue there's a new kind of metafiction used by certain authors to think one's way into a shared space between one being and another. Now I think that's quite a valuable notion, that's the one I want to pick up on. But first of all, I want to broaden out a little bit and say that Boxall's comments on metafiction need to be placed into a broader context. And I think there are two things in particular that Boxall also represents that we need to know. That's not it, actually. I'm going to give you a quick preview there and go back again. He says there's two main things. The first thing is he thinks that we're now entering a different phase of contemporary literature where there's a global community of writers, an emerging canon of international literary fiction, as he calls it. And he includes some of the writers who would cross that boundary between postmodernism and post-postmodernism, such as Margaret Atwood, Don DeLillo, Paul Auster, Thomas Pynchon. Those are writers who were writing in the heyday of postmodernism and have continued to write and are now moving into a different phase. But there's also newly emerging writers, and he lists an enormous number of these. I won't go through all the lists, but they include such writers from the UK as David Mitchell, from the US, such as Dave Eggers, for example, and Orhan Pamuk is also included in that list. So he's a kind of global writer, and what Boxall means is that these writers are actually addressing a global audience. And I think the problem is perhaps illustrated by Pamuk's inclusion in that list, because the danger is that the specificity, the national specificity of such writers gets lost. But nevertheless, I think there's a valuable point here that he's kind of saying that there's the equivalent of globalisation in these writers, that they almost package something up that can be read in different nations. These fictions, he says, deal with hybrid identity, most of all, and instantaneity, as he calls it, the idea of time being instant, time having been compressed by all of our digital technology. He thinks the novel is the perfect form for this. So that's one thing that he says is crucial. And the second feature, I think, is this question of the shared space between one being and another. The key idea is that contemporary fiction is defined by the determination amongst novelists to reject postmodern irony and introspection in favour of emotionality, sharing, and truthful commitment. And in a way, this is a return to a previous ideal of liberalism, which has always run through the Anglo-American novel. The idea of respecting otherness in fiction has always been part and parcel of the novel as a form. And there's been a number of terms for this from other recent critics, such as a new existential engagement by one critic, or a new generation of believers by another. But I think the most enduring term has been the term the new sincerity, which is a term that comes from the work of David Foster Wallace, one of the most influential. I was going to call him a young American writer, but he did actually end his life at only 46, so a young writer that obviously won't be producing any more, very sadly, but very influential. And this notion of the new sincerity is one that has been taken up by a number of different critics. He was actually, David Foster Wallace, about actually moving beyond irony, what he saw as a kind of constricting form. Although he wasn't explicitly advocating any kind of return to modernism, modernism has always been concerned with sincerity. And that's, in a sense, what David Foster Wallace was yearning for, even though his work itself is deeply ironic, as I'll come on to. So I want to come on to the specific question of how sincerity does operate in literature, and how that might relate to the opposite, which is suspicion. But first, though, I want to suggest how pervasive the faith in sincerity is throughout culture at the moment. So I want to turn to two examples from a more kind of popular form that was carried across, perhaps, to more people than fiction, in a sense. This is a work of art by the French artist Cyprien Gaillard, who is known kind of loosely as, or he's part of a group known loosely as the YBA, the Young Berlin Artists. Now he's French, but he works in Berlin, and this was an exhibition in Berlin. It was a 72,000 bottle pyramid of beer exhibited in an art gallery. Now, I'm sure you'll notice straight away that's Efes beer. And this choice of beverage prompted one art blogger to say that this was therefore a pinnacle of modern art as we know it. I'm not sure if that's because of Efes or because of the pinnacle of the pyramid. It was known as a beerimid, of course, inevitably. But I think it's a fascinating and powerful work of art, which does emphasise this new move, I think, towards sincerity and an emotional connection between people. Because the key thing about this is that it could be an interactive installation. And that's what people began to realise. These were boxes of beer, which could be opened, which could be consumed, which could be shared. So this is what happened in the exhibition. So people actually consumed the beer in it. So all at once, the installation performed the very destruction and colonial consumption it stood for in its original state. Yet at the same time, it made for a very real coming together of people from different parts of the world. And the pyramid stands for monuments, in a sense. And perhaps the way that monuments have a transcultural significance, perhaps even the fact that Berlin's history is full of examples of monuments being taken from one place and stored in another. So what happened with the installation actually enacted this question of destruction, but also a coming together. Destruction was at the same time a way of building connections. And in this way it also challenges the conventional modernist approach to the art gallery, where work is curated and presented for individual solitary detached contemplation and consumption. That isn't how this art gallery worked. Visiting an art space became an act of actually collective coming together, sharing a beer. Viewers participated in the work. Now the title of the artwork, which I actually didn't write up there, sorry, is called The Recovery of Discovery. Now I think that's a very kind of post-modern title, The Recovery of Discovery. It's almost as if the pleasure, the innocence of discovery has been lost in the previous period, and we have to recover this. And I think in the case of this installation, the outline of the beer pyramid could still be made out, so it sort of suggests there are traces of the monument still there, traces of the past. And I should just add one footnote. Of course, this is a very particular kind of coming together. Not every culture comes together through alcohol. And even the choice of Efes may be significant. Now, Efes, of course, is a hugely successful multinational corporation, which is Turkish owned, and in a sense symbolises or stands in for multinational profit-making companies. So whether or not this is a kind of endorsement or a critique of that, I'm not sure. I'll leave that for you to decide. But I think that's very significant of this kind of post-postmodern move towards emotional connection between creator and client, which eventually I'll say is between author and reader. But I want to give one more example. This comes from pop culture. This is the film Passengers. Now, has this film made it to Turkey? Is this a...
Yes.
Yeah. Did you enjoy the film? I mean, I think it's a deeply flawed film, but a kind of fascinating film. I'm one of these people that starts watching films, and once I realise that they're interesting to write about, I kind of like them, you know, in the end. But I wasn't sure about this one. Now, for those of you who haven't seen the film, this is a set in a future world where humans are able to choose to become cryogenically frozen, kind of classic sci-fi trope, in order to migrate to a different planet. So, as is often the case with sci-fi at the moment, there's an implicit suggestion that our culture has somehow destroyed itself through ecological catastrophe. The people on the ship are cryogenically frozen, and of course they pay to do this. So not, this isn't accessible to everyone. Now, the twist is, or the original premise is, it's a story of how one man is mysteriously woken up 90 years too early, because they have to travel a long distance, so they're sleeping for, I think it's 180 years or something. He's woken up 90 years too early. And that means, of course, that he's essentially condemned to die on the ship, because his normal human lifespan reverts as soon as he wakes up. He is surrounded by 5,000 sleeping people. Even the crew are still asleep. But because it's high tech, the computer system still works. He's able to have the pick of all the different refectories and restaurants and bars, etc., which are all computer operated. So he's faced with spending the rest of his life alone, trapped aboard the ship, until another passenger is woken up. Now, authorial intervention is more subtle in cinema. It is possible to reproduce the effects of metafiction directly. Some films have tried to do this, but usually it's quite difficult to do this. It's quite clumsy, in a sense. Yet it more often works through the logic of intertextuality in film. That's how you get the hand of the auteur or the hand of the director being made clear to you. And Passengers is obviously part of the tradition of sci-fi reimaginings of Robinson Crusoe. So films such as The Omega Man or I Am Legend, more recently, are versions of this. The empty ship full of vast spaces intended for use by thousands of passengers, and its cool, indifferent, dispassionate system interfaces is slightly eerie. And viewers have also been schooled by decades of sci-fi, from Kubrick's 2001, A Space Odyssey, to Alien, to Moon, all films which show a corporation exploring space in the interest of making money, and which reveals a sinister, hostile side to the colonial enterprise. Therefore, the viewer receives at least the first half of Passengers suspiciously, awaiting some kind of dark twist, which their schooling in the whys and wherefores of cinema, especially sci-fi, have prepared them for. And I think there's almost certainly deliberate echoes of Stanley Kubrick's film, The Shining. You know, a terrifying, wonderful film. But another movie about a man who ends up alone in an entire remote leisure complex and goes mad, of course, famously, terrorising his wife and son. And I think the homage is most clear in the bartender scene, that you have this kind of, on the left, the bartender is actually an android. And on the right, that's the film The Shining. But you can tell by the colours, by the look of the film, by the look of the barman, that this is a deliberate echo of The Shining. So what happens is, a combination of the sci-fi tradition and the reference to The Shining in particular sets up our expectations, communicating subtly to the viewer that the company behind this this migration of people, which are known as Homestead 2, is up to something. Either with the whole business of transporting the passengers, or with the apparent error of waking Jim Preston, the hero, up too early. And there are revelations. You know, he finds out things about the vast sums of money that this company is making in this business. So viewers naturally wonder, is it going to harvest the people in their pods? Is there something Earth doesn't know about its future or about Homestead, this company? Is Jim placed on some kind of mission? Or is he going insane, like Jack Torrance in The Shining? That it's not really about suspicion. It can encourage suspicion. And actually, shameless to give you a spoiler, in a sense, is that that's not the case. It's just an accident.
And I think that's actually how people deal with the accident.
On the one hand, this is why the film is obviously disappointing, despite its interesting Prince. Now, all the crisis boils down to the disaster in Poland, dealing with Hollywood,
caused by a meteor which started this already.
And this is causes.
Isn't Hollywood always sincere?
So, the last part of the film was a rather predictable and plausible race against time to fix this.
Or, to put it differently, Hollywood doesn't do sophisticated irony.
You can guess that, don't
you? But actually, it's not
the messages, because the messages are passengers about one, enduring love conquering all, or two, that we're only passengers throughout life. That's where the title comes from, and it's kind of said in a rather glib way by another character who I haven't mentioned yet. This is a sort of sincere message, I suppose, but it's banal in the way that Hollywood blockbusters can be. So the problem is that the message about sincerity and connection, which I think is crucial to contemporary fiction, and what other critics have said is crucial to contemporary fiction, is replicated in the most base examples of pop culture. In another recent Hollywood movie, Collateral Beauty. You can tell I've done a lot of travelling on planes recently. That's where I've watched all these slightly inferior movies. But we have Will Smith as this charismatic advertising executive who tells his company at the start, this kind of adoring company, what is your why? Why did you get up this morning? Why did you eat what you ate? Wore what you wore? We're certainly not here to sell shit. We're here to connect. Life is about people. So, you know, we're here to connect. Life is about people. That's a kind of banal message, and it's wrapped up in this question of capitalism, which is uncontested in this particular film. That's what happens when pop culture tries to deal, I think, with some moral issues very commonly. And this is what David Foster Wallace was concerned about, because he thought irony originally did have a crucial value in US metafiction. You know, he didn't want to actually deny the value of the works of people like Pynchon and Vonnegut and John Barth. There's a kind of edible anxiety that he acknowledged. You know, he wanted to write something different. He wanted to throw off the shackles of these powerful precursors, but he didn't want to disregard their value. However, he thinks that the irony that they specialised in was actually taken up by pop culture, and in particular American TV. So American TV, from the 70s onwards, started to use the same kind of self-reflexive and ironic techniques that literature of the postmodern kind used. And that meant that if irony is everywhere in pop culture and it becomes absorbed into these kind of messages, can there be any value in literary irony? And his answer was no. His answer was that we have to somehow get beyond this kind of irony. How can we move beyond this? The problem is that once the rules of art are debunked and once the unpleasant realities and ironic the irony diagnosis are revealed and diagnosed, then what do? Irony is useful for debunking illusions, but most of the illusion debunking in the US is now being done and redone. Postmodern irony and cynicism has become an end in itself, a measure of hip sophistication and literary savvy. Few artists dare to try to talk about ways of working towards redeeming what's wrong, because they'll look sentimental and naive to all the weary ironists. Irony's gone from liberating to enslaving. And this is an argument that he put forward very eloquently, time and again in interviews, in an essay, the most important essay is E. Universe Plural, which is about American television and metafiction, but also in his fiction too. So this is why literary fiction, I think, is especially valuable. Partly because there's a problem. How do you follow irony when irony is everywhere in pop culture? But it's also valuable because literary fiction deals with sophisticated language and deals with, I think, a more complex exchange between reader and writer or author and, or creator and client than Hollywood cinema. So literature is the battleground for this question about irony versus sincerity in modern fiction. And that's what I want to do in the rest of this paper. And I think, before I do that, I just want to quickly go back to the question of suspicion. The great spokesperson, the equivalent of Foster Wallace, I think, was Nathalie Sarraute, the French writer of the New Allemand. And she famously wrote an essay called The Age of Suspicion. That's how she defined the modernist period, really. You know, she was writing before postmodernism. This was in 1965, before postmodernism really became widely known. And she thinks suspicion was the key element. That there's a faith, the faith in realism was waning amongst readers and writers alike. Both of them were suspicious about the whole realist ethos.
profound, and she looked back to modernism, but also she's looking at the Nouveau Roman in France, which she produced as well as other people herself. A new kind of narrator is produced. An anonymous eye who is at once all and nothing, and who, as often as not, is but the reflection of the author himself, has usurped the role of the hero, occupying the place of honour. What happens practically, she says, in this new age of suspicion, is that the reader is dispossessed. He or she becomes enticed into the author's territory, so that the reader is on the inside, exactly where the author is, at a depth where nothing remains of the convenient landmarks which he, with which he constructs the characters. So to give one of her best examples of this, she looks at the works of Proust. She does look at the work of Proust, but the best examples are when she looks to Kafka and The Trial, and to Joyce and Finnegan's Wake. And both of those texts use heroes who have just initials. There's Josef K. And there's H.C.E. Ewaker, known as H.C.E. in Finnegan's Wake. And our point is that the use of initials prevents the reader from ever getting away from the fact that this has been controlled by the author. This is the author's decision to withhold the real name for us. It's not the pretense of realism anymore. It's kind of saying, this is a fictional character, and I'm in control of this fictional character. And the reader knows this. So both of them are suspicious about realism and end up in this place on the inside where they can share that suspicion. And I think you can say that this, even though she was writing before postmodernism, her model of an attitude of productive mutual suspicion between author and reader applies to much postmodern metafiction. Now, to list some classic examples, which are so classic I don't need to spend much time on them, and you'll know them. Classic examples of frame breaking, which have the attitude of suspicion behind them. Perhaps the most famous, because it's one of the first, the most radical examples, is John Fowles' The French Lieutenant's Woman, published in 1969. Now, you'll know that this is from the notorious Chapter 13. Chapter 12 ends with the narrator, who's still a version of the third-person omniscient realist narrator, looking at his character, Sarah, and saying, who is Sarah? Out of what shadows does she come? And then when you turn the page, there's the classic moment of frame-breaking, and the author intervenes directly. And says, I do not know. This story I'm telling is all imagination. These characters I create never existed outside my own mind. If I pretended until now to know my character's mind and inmost thoughts, it's because I'm writing in a convention universally accepted at the time of my story, etc., etc. And this goes on for that chapter. And that work of frame breaking is means that you can never suspend your disbelief while reading that novel again. You're suspicious. You know that the novelist is manipulating you because he tells you repeatedly. So that's very typical of metafiction, of course. It's the same with Robert Coover's famous story, The Magic Poker. Some of you may teach that, I'm not sure. I always used to teach that to teach metafiction because it's such a short story and very, very clear about what it does. But The Magic Poker begins with the famous line, I wander the island, inventing it. So right from the start, the author is kind of intervening in the narrative. And then another classic example is Paul Auster's The New York Trilogy, or City of Glass, the first example, when there's the wrong number which starts it, and Quinn actually answers the phone, and the voice on the other end asks for Paul Auster. Of course, that's a kind of jarring moment of ontological confusion, and what you do is you look back at the cover and think, Paul Auster, I thought he was the author. So the author's kind of breaking the frame in that sense. So in the terms of Nathalie Sarraute, what's happening at moments like this in postmodern texts is that the reader is being drawn into the author's territory, finding himself or herself on the inside, exactly where the author is. And this situation sustained an attitude of suspicion toward realism, and indeed the entire act of fiction itself. Now, I don't think for a moment anyone would accuse writers such as Fowles, Coover, Auster, etc., of being somehow insincere. It's clear to me that ironic language can be quite compatible with sincerity. And I think one only has to look at Slaughterhouse-Five, Kurt Vonnegut's novel, which is, I think, a beautiful, very moving novel, but deeply ironic and introspective and metafictional, but nevertheless very powerful, because the metafiction and the irony works as a displacement mechanism. It's very clear that the narrator can't deal with the traumatic events he's had to deal with. The narrator is Vonnegut. Vonnegut was party, was witness to the bombing of Dresden in 1945, and had to find a way of telling the story, and couldn't do it directly. So I think that's a sincere novel, without any doubt. However, and I think this is the point about 21st century sincerity in fiction, the mutually suspicious relationship between author and reader in postmodernism is not the kind of two-way relationship that Wallace and his generation seek. In postmodern literature, from their point of view, Wallace and his generation, it's a matter of the author being in control, treating the reader like someone enlisted as a witness or a sounding board or even a kind of therapist for the author to work through his problems, which is precisely what Vonnegut is doing, you know, explicitly in Slaughterhouse-5. Literary criticism about the Wallace generation has actually seen the return of the Bakhtinian term dialogic into literary criticism. I think that kind of disappeared for a little while, but it's back because it's very much in keeping with how this relationship between author and reader actually works. And it's good to have it back. So there may be two people present in John Fowles's chapter 13. You know, the reader is very much the addressee, very much being included in this discussion, but it's not a dialogue. It's dialogic in the Bakhtinian sense, I suppose, that Fowles's discourse is driven by his anticipation of a future answer word, his consciousness of another, but his point of view isn't challenged in the text, nor is it open to challenge. And this is something that Linda Hutchings, in her first book, Narcissistic Narrative, which oddly enough doesn't mention postmodernism, she prefers the term historiographic metafiction, as you know. She thought that would catch on, but never did. I wonder why. But she says that postmodern fiction, she doesn't use the term, is didactic. It kind of allows the reader a kind of freedom, but it's a conscripted freedom. It's a constrained freedom. And it's something like this kind of logic that no proper dialogue is there in metafiction that leads David Foster Wallace to try and challenge it in his own fiction. Most notably a story called Westward, The Course of Empire Takes Its Way, which I won't try and summarise because it's such a complex story. It's a novella really rather than a story. And what it does is it meditates John Barth's famous story, Lost in the Funhouse. And it tries to suggest that there's a problem with Lost in the Funhouse because the reader isn't loved. The reader isn't allowed a position where he or she can experience things properly. It's too didactic. I'm not sure it's a very convincing explanation, actually. It is torturous, but in a sense it doesn't matter because the torture is evidence of the value that Wallace attaches to this kind of dialogic relationship within metafiction. So Wallace set himself a very difficult task. How, when we're kind of post-ironic, can you continue to write self-reflexive fiction? You know, you can't just go back to the 19th century. How can you continue to write that kind of fiction but create more of a productive, mutually fair relationship between author and reader? Whether or not he succeeds, I don't know. A very useful essay is Adam Kelly's essay on the writers of The New Sincerity. It's called David Foster Wallace and The New Sincerity. And it's a very good article because he demonstrates the depth of the specific problem when it comes to determining sincerity in literature. Put simply, a sincere gesture or statement always opens its receiver up to the possibility that this is in fact insincere or ironic, simply an act of persuasion or judgment. To explain this, Kelly draws on Derrida's logic of the gift, as that which is founded upon paradox. Sincerity, he says, I think I have the quotation here somewhere. Yeah, sincerity is the same structure as the gift, the middle quotation there. It can always be taken for manipulation. And this risk is fundamental. It cannot be reduced by appeal to intention or morality or context, because true sincerity, if there ever is such a thing, must take place in the apparatus between the conditional and the unconditional. Now, you may be aware that the theory of the gift, the economic theory of the gift, which goes back to Master and Mouse, was dealt with by Georges Bataille, is that when you, in primitive cultures, the gift is a crucial form of exchange. It has a double effect. On the one hand, it expresses gratitude. On the other hand, it invites a return gift. So it's manipulative as well as being a kind of genuine gift in that sense. And that's kind of what he's saying about sincerity. In order to be sincere, you have to run the risk of manipulation. And it's almost like the Cretan liar's paradox, that if you're told that I am being sincere, I may be being insincere by saying this. And I think you can see the problem just by using a very typical phrase of Wallace. He was interviewed by Dave Eggers, who in many ways is, if not a successor, but a writer who shares some of the same kind of values and approaches that David Foster was. This is an interview, it's talking about the US election in 2004 and how Wallace was actually going to participate in campaigning for this. So it was a genuine kind of ethical gesture by Wallace. This is how he puts it. He said, "My own plan for the coming 14 months is to knock on doors and stuff envelopes, maybe even to wear a button, to try to accrete with others into a demographically significant mass, to try extra hard to exercise patience, politeness and imagination and those with whom I agree. Also, to floss more." Now he means dental flossing. So that kind of ironic conclusion could completely invalidate the entire statement. You know, it might make you think he's being actually insincere, he's not going to do any campaigning at all. But we have to take him at his word, we have to trust him in a sense. And this is kind of what the literature of sincerity does, in a more complex way because it's literature. We must, as Kelly suggests, acknowledge the dialogic appeal to the reader's attestation and judgment. And the relationship is exemplified, Kelly argues, through by the last line of a quite an interesting novel that was written by Dave Eggers called What Is the What? Which is a really curious novel because it's called a novel. You can actually see there, What Is the What? A novel by Dave Eggers. But it's actually an autobiography. So Dave Eggers is actually writing in the voice of Valentino Achak Deng, who was a Sudanese migrant. Who was separated from his family during the Second Sudanese War, then managed to escape to first a refugee camp in Ethiopia with a group of other young boys, known as the Lost Boys, and then when soldiers attack them in this camp following the usurpation of the Ethiopian president Mengistu, flees to another camp in Kenya, and eventually is able to emigrate to the United States as part of the Lost Boys of Sudan program. And the last line is, "How can I pretend that you do not exist? It would almost be as impossible as you pretending that I do not exist." It's a direct address to the reader, almost laying it out there saying, "No, you must believe in me, I believe in you." And he thinks that's a key element of sincerity. And I think it becomes complex in this novel because of this complex narration. Eggers made this choice. He says here, "When the book was in a more straightforward authorial voice, I missed the voice I was hearing on the tapes. So writing in Val's voice solved both problems. I could disappear completely, and the reader would have the benefit of his own very distinct voice." Now, of course, he can't disappear completely. And it's been suggested by Peter Boxall, to come back to Peter's work, that, ironically, that if What Is the What is a story about Deng's struggle to achieve a sense of his own identity as a forced migrant, then Eggers' invisible presence in the process, a form of colonial authority, translating and colouring Deng's voice, is an intimate part of that story. And it means that What Is the What is preoccupied at all times with the circumstances of its own production. You're reading Valentino Achak Deng's story, you're reading his voice, but you know that his voice is actually being ventriloquized, it's being produced by another, who happens to be a white American. So it's very problematic, I think, in post-colonial terms. But what Boxall and Adam Kelly and so on think is valuable about this novel is this ethics of sincerity. It almost takes that risk in order to make a more important case. As Boxall writes, to tell one's story in Eggers' novel is not to rediscover an authentic, self-possessed African voice, but to open oneself to translation, to double voicing. Okay, so now I have my conclusion. What Is the What illustrates what I think is another of the key defining features of post-postmodernist fiction, and that's its sense of its social mission. And I'm using this term, I'm deliberately drawing, going back to Chris Baldick's pioneering analysis of the emergence of English literature as a discipline in universities in the late 19th century. I mean, to put it bluntly, English literature was designed to replace religion. The people in the late 19th century felt the values of religion were actually dying out and they needed to be replaced somehow. And where better to find them than literature? Now, of course, it depends which work of literature you want to look for your values. You know, if you want to look to Titus Andronicus, for example, that's not a good example. But that was the kind of ideology behind the establishment of English literature in American in English universities. And it's called the social mission of English criticism. So I think literature, in a sense, has this renewed emphasis on a social mission in post-modernity. And one of the key values was, in fact, sincerity. I.A. Richard's famous project that introduced close reading, really, to universities, known as practical criticism, emphasised sincerity as one of the key values. But what's fascinating, I think, and this is not dealt with by people like Kelly or Robert Boxall, is that sincerity is about not the author, but the reader. It's sincerity on the part of the receiver of the message, rather than the deliverer of the message. And the result is that what is really tested, I'm quoting here from Baldick, is solely the personality of the reader in a struggle with his or her own soul, ideally in Richard's view, an inner striving for sincerity. So what does it mean to receive something sincerely, as well as deliver it sincerely? If we apply this logic to post-postmodern fiction, it means that the sincerity of the author and his or her utterance is not enough. The reader needs to be sincere too. Just as the reader of the Nouveau Roman or the postmodern novelist needed to match the author's suspicious attitude toward literature, so the reader of post-postmodern narrative must be sincere in his or her approach to fiction. So finally, I think we could describe this in terms of Paul Ricoeur's famous analysis of the hermeneutics of postmodernity. Ricoeur is perhaps most famous for his phrase, the hermeneutics of suspicion, and this refers to the interpretive approach used by the three masters of suspicion, as he calls them, Freud, Marx and Nietzsche, all of whom have an approach to text which suggests that they don't believe what's on the surface, and we shouldn't believe in that either. It's a suspicious form of reading. And this is really what we teach university students, how to read suspiciously. Never trust what you're given at face value. Now, of course, that is a value, isn't it? That's one of the real values, I think, of literary studies, is that students learn not to take things at face value. And it has a political consequence, but I think that kind of training. But Ricoeur actually compares this to what he calls the hermeneutics of faith. And that phrase isn't often used very often. As Don Ider, the editor of Essays in Hermeneutics, puts it, once phenomenology has passed through the chastisement of a suspicious hermeneutic, there is no recovery of a simple faith. If faith is to survive, it must be informed, it must be a critical faith. So it's a bit like going back to the 19th century realism, you can't do it. Once you've gone through suspicion, you can't simply return to faith. So ultimately, Ricoeur knew there had to be a third position. Despite the enormous influence of Marx, Nietzsche and Freud, neither of these forms of interpretation, suspicion or belief, according to Ricoeur, actually wins out and characterises the age. This tension, he said, the tension between suspicion and sincerity, this extreme polarity, is the truest expression of our modernity. So suspicion and sincerity, in Ricoeurian terms, are two hermeneutic styles which are polarised and produce a valuable tension. On the one hand, in terms of the human hermeneutics of faith, we have hermeneutics as the manifestation and restoring of a meaning addressed to me in the manner of a message, a proclamation, or as it's sometimes said, a kerygma, that's a kind of proclamation. And on the other, in terms of suspicion, we have interpretation understood as a demystification, as a reduction of illusion. Now it strikes me that we're in a similar position in post-postmodernism. Postmodernism may have been underscored by a hermeneutics of suspicion, but the mutual attitude of suspicion must be acknowledged to include sincerity on the part of both author and reader. Equally, we cannot simply move into an era of sincerity and wish away the previous generation's emphasis on suspicion. It's clear that as sincere as they are, as committed to sustaining a new ethos of human connection and sharing, writers like David Foster Wallace or Dave Eggers are also concerned to unmask and to probe beneath the surface of the work of their postmodernist forebears. So we must acknowledge that both styles are continually present in post-postmodernism and wider culture in dialogue with each other. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Brian. Really full paper with philosophical insights into postmodernism and its aftermath and today. Sincerity is probably the major contribution that postmodernism has brought in, and we may call it perhaps courtesy with frankness, instead of hiding and sort of repressing some of the things that we can't speak. Postmodernism has enabled us to speak them up, and so there has been a sincere communication then with among people, with the author and the reader, and as well as in terms of hermeneutic, in terms of interpretation and understanding, sure. But, yes, the other perhaps value of postmodernism, maybe I gather from your discussion that it has definitely enabled us to rehold what we have learned and known before, in order to revisit our knowledge, to revisit our sources and the impact for mankind. And so perhaps you take some questions or comments from the floor.
Absolutely, I haven't run too far over time.
Right, so you are welcome with your comments or with your questions.
You can be sincere, all our comments.
Yes, I can see you, yes. It's a bit gloomy inside, yes.
Paper. As far as I understand, you mentioned the French Lieutenant's Woman's abstract, little quotation as an example of suspicion, right? Because once we enter that world, we're always going to be suspicious as we read the novel. But the easier way to read it is as a moment of sincerity on the part of the author. So I'm wondering if the suspicion and sincerity are interlocked in ways that are very crucial.
Yes. Yeah, the short answer is yes, you're absolutely right, actually. And this is where I was going at the end, I think, that the two attitudes actually work together. But what I didn't do was actually go back and say that this is an operation, I think, in postmodernism. You know, I do think sincerity is there. So Fowles is being sincere, but I think the difference, though, is that it kind of sets up a practice of reading. It sets up an approach to reading which is suspicious. So once there is this intervention in chapter 13, the sense is that the reader cannot be other than suspicious. Again, whereas when you read Wallace or Eggers, there's a sense that the author doesn't want you to be suspicious at all. He wants you to trust them. Now, that doesn't mean you can't be suspicious because of suspicious reading. So I think the short answer is that there's a dialectic between the two things. So you're right. There's one.
Yeah. While listening to you, I'm also reminded of Georges Poulet's article, which relates to the question of the materiality of the book itself. So the suspicion, I thought, could be related to our questioning of what we hold at hand, how we enter into it, whether we are outside it or inside it, as well.
So you mean in terms of the actual object?
Yeah.
That we become, yeah, we have a healthy suspicion of what
we do. Yeah. Aren't we becoming more conscious of the materiality of books as well?
So when you say materiality, do you mean in terms of the mechanics of the industry?
Both the industry and talking all that time.
I think also the question of this question of suspicion works well.
I think it's healthy.
I think it's interpretive. So I think on the face of the postmodern text, I'm actually. But yes, I mean, I've got a dialogical question of this. As the author is trying to control the points of view, and I think it does in most of the classic postmodern texts.
Yes, I think we have a very tight schedule, and there's a short coffee break, and then we'll have the final morning session.
Since most of the
thank you very much.